Now, from the WTAE Channel 4 studios, this is McDonald's Action Sports Sunday.
Welcome to another edition of McDonald's Action Sports Sunday, the show beyond a shadow of a doubt, the most electrifying sports talk show in all of Western Pennsylvania. Now, if that doesn't get you to keep watching, I don't know what will. Let's meet this week's panel. Speaking of electrifying, he is from the Pittsburgh Tribune Review and the DVE Morning Show, and he's got his eyes on you. Mike Prisuta is here. Always great to have the Triv here. Also here, he's been filling in for the vacationing guy Junker all week from 105.9 The X and Fox Sports 970. The Minnow, Tim Benz, the pride of Syracuse University. And also here, the Great White Shark from Fox Sports 970, Joe Bendel, who's taking apparently issue with Mike Prisuta over there. And, yeah. I'll tell you what,
that wasn't the guy goes like this, you put your hand.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure.
What are you the pride of?
What am I the pride of?
I'm the pride of McKeesport, PA.
I guess Lions are in a pride, right? So maybe I'm part of the Lion family, I guess.
All right, gentlemen, the Steelers dropped to 1-1 in the NFL preseason with a 13-9 loss over to the Green Bay Packers last night at Heinz Field. And, you know, it's only preseason, but it's our job to create panic throughout the city. And I guess you have to talk about the offensive line and the sputtering Steelers offense, even though the first team only got a couple of series. Big Ben, 2 for 2, 14 yards. Didn't see a whole lot. Again, they probably weren't showing a whole lot. But is it reason for Steeler fans to panic about the offense right now?
Not about the offense, JB. We got to start with the special teams.
Oh, yeah.
They practice every day. Twice a day. Everything you could possibly think of. But what
no
do they not practice?
No volleyballs.
Blocking for a place kick. They can't convert a place kick. Mike Tomlin identifies it after the Hall of Fame game as an area of concern. Substandard, he told the team when he delivered the news. The field goal protection was not good enough. Do they fix it? No, they get worse.
And that's the worst kind of block is to come right up the middle. You could see if somebody is quick on the outside and they're able to get in and dive and block the ball. But this PAT attempt was blocked completely up the middle.
Nobody blocks an extra point. I mean, how many times you see a missed extra point
and it was
in the NFL anymore? That's the problem.
Yeah, they made it look easy.
We saw Cameron Stevenson not get on the field on time for a kicking situation. We also saw a holding penalty by Deshae Townsend, excuse me. So, the Steelers, you're right, Mike, as much time as they spend on the special teams, and we talk about it all the time because we have to, because the Steelers let us know how often they're working on it. It's pretty dangerous whenever you get into a game situation and your guys aren't getting it done for you. I don't know what to say about it other than I guess you better keep working on it. You got three more preseason games. But I've always said it, and I've said it to you many times, Mike Prisuta, special teams is 20% of the game, not 33% of the game. Spend more time on offense and defense.
Do they need to go to 2 hours now on their special teams only workouts? And they were kind of crowing about, hey, you know what, we spend a whole hour on special teams. Look at us and look at the results.
Well, what is the goal of the volleyball anyway? Is it to make sure that you...
So you don't break your fingers when you're blocking.
Oh, is that what it is? Okay.
Yeah.
Well, then maybe they should use one of those soft, cushy dodgeballs that they have at gym class or something like that.
But they use Nerf balls to practice downing punts. And they use those hoops that they put on the ground so you go to Akron and back before you try to block the kick just so you won't get a rough and penalty. I'm having some fun with them here. I don't think it's a panic situation.
Right.
But it is significant to me that Mike Tomlin would identify this as a problem area, and it would get worse, not better, from week one to week two. That is not an encouraging sign.
And
the players have been grumbling a little bit.
59-yard punt with direction.
Maybe
that was pretty good.
Misdirecting our special teams efforts, and instead of playing with the toys, we ought to be doing something a little more productive. They're going to do it this week, because Tomlin said they're going live, and they're going to block field goals and practice protecting on field goals until he's satisfied.
Let me help you out here real quick. I will inspire a little bit of panic about the offense.
Okay. Go right ahead,
the
please.
The offensive line specifically, never in the history of the NFL has this phrase been uttered. That was a good team that won the Super Bowl, but the offensive line was shaky. You've had shaky running backs. You might have even had shaky quarterbacks or even occasionally a shaky defense. The Colts that weren't that great of a defense until the playoffs started last year. The offensive line has to come together. I'm not sure if it will as well as it did a couple years ago. I think there's potential for it, but the offensive line is where there needs to be some concern right now.
And can Steely McBean block on those extra point kicks? That's the question. I mean, you might be able to put
Steely
the big
McBean
guy.
Steely McBean can do
guy
it all.
May be able to step it up a little bit.
All right.
Keep an eye on it.
Whose stock went up as a result of last night's game? Whose stock went down in terms of making the team, not making the team? Where do you put Walter Young after the play he made last night?
Well, they put him in the game ahead of Dallas Baker, who I believe was the seventh wide receiver
sent into the game last night. Both of those guys are kind of similar players. Walter Young is a big guy who has more experience than does Dallas Baker. Dallas Baker's a big guy who was a draft pick this year. I'd have to say the Baker stock went down. Kerry Davis, I think, goes up. He played fullback last night. Mike Tomlin initially impressed, though he didn't want to commit to actually praising someone until he had seen the film.
Right.
That position flexibility that he talks about so much, I don't think he's just saying that to hear his own voice.
Well, I don't know if Max Starks had any stock as a left tackle, but if there was any, it went down. I know they're trying to do what they can with him to make him a swing guy, but I'll tell you, it doesn't really look good with Max at left tackle right now. He's trying to hang on to right tackle, but if you're going to do stock down a left tackle, I think you can go with Max.
Shark, real quick.
I just think Gary Russell. I mean, Gary Russell for the first two games this season has looked pretty good. It's the preseason, but he has that great acceleration. I kind of compare sometimes when I watch running backs, like, how does Najee Davenport hit the hole? How does Kevin Barlow hit the hole? How does Gary Russell
hit the hole? Like Deuce
Staley. I think, right. Well, last year, John Kuhn was hitting the hole a little bit better than Deuce Staley.
22 or 33, and,
you know, I'm a John Kuhn fan, but Gary Russell has something special there. I'm not calling him a breakout back this season for the Steelers, but I think it's going to be very hard not to keep this kid on the team. And the hard part is now he's playing so well in the preseason, you try to put him on the practice squad, and there's other teams watching this kid. Right. They may pick him up and put him on the roster. But if you're talking about stock up, he seemed to really jump off the page.
All right, we've got to take a quick break, talk about the Pitt football situation. Not Whoa. Good. Derek
stock
Kinder
down?
Out for the year. Stock down. We'll talk more after this. I love this part of the show. It's the Barrel Automotive Barometer, brought to you by the fine folks at Barrel Automotive. Time to see who's stock up or stock down. That's a popular word on this show. In the world of sports, Tiger Woods, yes, sir. 13 majors, thank you very much. Won the PGA Championship. He's a new father. He's got lots of money in the bank. Yeah, he's always going to be up. Steeler offensive line, you heard Tim Benz talk about it. A lot of shuffling going on and a few sacks last night in the game against the Green Bay Packers. They need to pick it up a little bit. And I'm sorry, folks, we're going to go down on the Steelers mascot, Steely McBean. He's not doing it for me. I just don't think the Steelers need a mascot.
It didn't look like they had one after the pregame introductions.
Yeah.
Where was it?
I thought he was going to be at the 50 and, you know, juggling and, you know.
I mean, if you're going to have a mascot, aren't you supposed to have a mascot?
You're like Kevin Barlow.
Just saying, we got a mascot. I don't know that gets it done. I think they're on the fence.
Cheerleaders are on the way. All right, guys, time to talk Pitt football. And it's been a not-so-good first week at Pitt camp. First, Pat Bostic, the freshman quarterback, Gatorade Player of the Year. He skips town, although we hear he's expected to be back sometime this week. Hopefully he's got whatever personal issues worked out that he needs to work out. Hopefully he'll be back. And then we get news today, Derek Kinder, their talented wide receiver, had a pretty good year last year, out for the season with an ACL situation with his knee. Could this have been a worse week for Dave Wannstedt and the Pitt Panther football program?
No, it's a tough one. I mean, this is a team, right? People picked to finish sixth in the Big East Conference, and we kind of knew why, and now it confirms everything. I mean, you have, you know, Bill Stahl, and I've been watching workouts this week. He tore up his thumb on a teammate's helmet, C.J. Davis's helmet. He's been out a little bit. He's not throwing the ball very well. Kevin Smith also having some struggles getting the ball downfield. I think a greater concern with this team might be they have a very good wide receiving core, and Derek Kinder not being there notwithstanding. Tamarcus Porter, Derek Turner, Cedric McGee, Maurice Williams, the list goes on. I'd be worried that, you know, these young kids are going to say, you know, I'm not happy that we don't have a quarterback who can deliver the ball to me. I want to get downfield and make plays. That's why I came here. And the quarterback position is so much in flux. There has to be some concern there. When you go into any season and you're not sure about your quarterback, and now your top recruit walks away for a few days, it's tough because the Big East is not a conference right now. The Pitt is ready to even be in the top tier. And when you have a quarterback issue like this, it makes it that much worse.
Let me just say this about the Pat Bostic situation.
So like cower there.
This kid is going to have to come clean about what happened and why he went home. And he's going to have to be a little bit more specific than, I just had some personal issues.
Well, his father said it's not about being homesick. It's not about a girlfriend issue or anything like
then
that.
Then what else is
it? It made it sound
it's
like...
It's pretty serious stuff, actually, from what I understand. I mean, these are young kids. I don't know how much he should disclose other than, hey, I'm back. I mean, I know he's in the media spotlight because he's a top recruit, but I would probably just, if I were him, I'd refrain from saying anything else. Get back into camp. It's only been a week. It's not that big of a deal. I mean, things happen.
Yeah, but this guy was supposed to
start.
This guy was supposed to scrap for a starting spot.
But I don't. At this point, I think his personal issues can be put aside and let him be back can, here. If he's a quarterback, he'll start.
Can he still catch up in time, Mike, to be the starter, you think, after missing a week?
Yeah, I mean, if he's
it's only a three-week camp.
If he's the guy they thought he was, you know, I didn't think anything's going to happen to Pitt this year. It looks kind of predetermined. Losing Kinder, does that mean they don't beat somebody they were supposed to beat? If they still had Kinder, would they beat Louisville? I think the only thing that can drastically impact Pitt's season is McCoy. If he is the real McCoy, they might be better than people think.
LeSean McCoy.
It's going to be interesting to see them have an actual legitimate D1 running back for a change and see how they can use that. They've been trying to set up a team that can pound away, run, stop the run. I think next year is going to be the definitive year for Dave Wannstedt and his staff. I think it was going to be that all along. I don't think a whole lot. There's a lot happening, but not much has changed, if that makes any sense.
Well, right. Derek Kidder's a stabilizer, though, Mike. I mean, he is a guy who was a semifinalist for Blitnikoff Award. Look, I have great receivers.
Like you said, they have a lot of receivers.
Right, no, they do. And they can run the ball. But this, what is it? It's a compilation of problems, though, when you lose a guy as a leader of your team like this. I mean, right. He was taking over that role, and then you have a quarterback who's supposed to be your top recruit. You're selling your program with this kid coming to your school, with the kids looking at this, saying, well, I want to go to Pitt, too. Now, they might be scratching their heads a little bit. It's going to be a tough start to the season. I agree with you, though. They have improved across the lines. They're a lot quicker than they were in any year I've ever seen them, probably over the past 7 years.
Yeah, Dave Wannstedt was saying he was impressed with the defensive line. I got to take a break and talk about Barry Bonds. I don't know if you remember this or not or heard this or not, but he did something really big this past week.
He's really big, too.
Yeah, he's built. Yeah, he's buff.
Big.
He works out.
Huge head.
Kyle's Action Sports Sunday rolls on this Sunday evening here in Western Pennsylvania. And, guys, Barry Bonds, he did it. Passed Hammer and Hank Aaron. He is the home run king. Whether you like it or you don't like it, you better learn to love it. And if that were all, that would be enough. But there's more. Giants in town tomorrow for a doubleheader with the Pirates. And they're supposed to honor Double B with a video tribute between games, although we don't even know if Barry's going to show up, if he's going to get on the plane to fly from San Francisco to Pittsburgh. What are your thoughts on the video tribute to Barry Bonds? And how significant was his career here in Pittsburgh? Obviously, he's going to be remembered as a San Francisco Giant, but how significant was that career here? He had 176 home runs as a Pirate. You know, where do you see that as the whole body of work?
Don't you think it's appropriate to do something like this if he was going to play or at least come out and doff his cap? I mean, if he's here, if he doesn't play, then I think we start to get into issues about whether or not it's worth it. It's going to look very funny to the Pirates or on behalf of the Pirates if he doesn't even poke his head out of the dugout to acknowledge the fact that they put a video tribute together. I was all on board with this idea. I thought they handled it perfectly at first, but maybe they should have found out if Barry was coming or planning to play first.
Well, there's going to be a lot of boos, obviously, when that video tribute begins. I mean, is it even worth it for the Pirates to do?
This is an incredibly bad idea for a couple of reasons. Number one, the Pirates came up with it. Number two, Barry Bonds, correct me if I'm wrong, guys, but didn't the Pirates a couple years ago host the All-Star game and then their media guy, didn't they have pictures of all the great Pirate All-Stars from all the way back to the Wainers and Honus Wagner and everybody, and they had not one picture of Barry Bonds in the media guy. The Pirates back in 92, I remember, they couldn't wait for Barry Bonds to leave. And for them to pull this kind of stunt, the third reason it's a terrible idea, I am not a fan of honoring anybody that's on the other team. I didn't like it when the Penguins honored Ron Francis, who left while he was still with the Carolina Hurricanes. I think there's plenty of time for that kind of stuff after a guy retires if you want
to. Well, it's two last-place teams.
This is not the time in Pittsburgh, absolutely not the time.
Well, we got less than a minute, so I want to get the Shark in here and get his thoughts.
I completely disagree. In fact, I hope Barry Bonds comes to Pittsburgh. I like the fact that there's a tribute to Barry Bonds. This is a guy, the only player in the history of the Pirates, has two MVP awards. He took the Pirates to the playoffs three consecutive years. I know he didn't have
but
great,
he couldn't throw out Sid Breed.
Great playoff appearances, but his on-base percentage wasn't bad. Also, too, I mean, if you look at what this guy has done throughout the course of his career, he broke the home run record. I mean, this is a guy who played in Pittsburgh. He started his career here. Yeah, celebrate. And you talk about the marketing by the Pirates. I think it's ingenious because you're either going to bring those who hate Barry Bonds to the park, and they'll fill it up and go through the turnstiles, or those who love him are going to come to the park as well and go through the turnstiles and cheer him. So I think it's perfect marketing by the Pirates, and They had a big ticket sales when it was announced it was going to happen. So a smart move overall. I enjoyed watching Barry Bonds play before he got thick and muscular and all those different things. And I'll continue to enjoy the guy. He's going to hit 30 home runs this year, too, by the way.
And they're going to finish last.
They're going to finish last. The Pirates
are very appropriate. He broke that record in a game they lost while they were in last place. Nice job, Barry. You the man.
All right, guys, less than a minute left. Tiger Woods, 13 majors. You know, he wins the PGA Championship. Any doubt in any of your minds that he will catch and pass the Golden Bear for most major wins all time?
No, but Mike Prisuta just told me he thought it would be a great idea if the Pirates honored him at PNC Park tomorrow.
Yeah, I think it's a great
idea. I think there's doubt. Part of that record's longevity. It's a long way to go. He's off to a great start, but you can't concede anything just yet. We all thought Griffey was going to be Barry Bonds one day 8 years ago, right?
That's true. Shark?
He is going to break all the records. I mean, he'll break Jack Nicklaus's record, I believe. Mike, you're right. Longevity is a component of this, but he's a young guy. I mean, he has a great golf ahead of him. You just watch him. Whenever he has that Tiger glare, he usually finishes it up, and he did it again today.
All right. Well, congratulations to Tiger, and congratulations to all of you for staying and watching us for 30 minutes. We do appreciate it.
It was worth your while, wasn't it?
McDonald's Action Sports Sunday is done for another Sunday night.
We'll see you next week.
Tribute to Mike Prisuta. Mike Prisuta Appreciation Week next week. Good night.